And we are so glad to have all of you here today. Just a few announcements before we begin. If you need to use the restrooms, they're straight through the doors and to the left. There's some right out there if you need them. There are also water fountains out the doors and down the hall to the right, along with more restrooms there. But just so delighted to have you here. If you're not doing anything on Sunday mornings at 9:30, you are welcome to join us here at the Church of the Red Rocks, where we believe no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey,
you are welcome here!
Woo! Nice job! It's such a delight to have all of our Sedona Academy of Chamber Singers here, and it's such a delight to have Katie Sheridan here, but I'm not supposed to introduce her. I'm going to introduce my good friend and colleague, Dr. Ryan Holder, who is the director of music here at the Church of the Red Rocks and also full professor now at Northern Arizona University. So, Dr. Ryan Holder.
My name is Ryan Holder. I'm the director of music here at the Church of the Red Rocks, as well as associate director of choral studies at Northern Arizona University. And this concert is always one of my favorites because it combines just both worlds in something that I love, which is choral music. What you're going to hear is you're going to hear a lecture recital featuring the Sedona Academy of Chamber Singers. This is an ensemble that serves as the choir residents here at the Church of the Red Rocks, and they graciously volunteered their time over the last month rehearsing for this particular concert. This concert is part of our Mars concert series, which is Music of the Red Rocks, that we do sponsor about 7 to 8 concerts per year. Without further ado, please invite, I'd like to invite forward the Sedona Academy Chamber Singers under the direction of Katie Sheridan.
June 15, 1866, in Armagh, England. He was the third son and fifth child of parents
scholarship applications, and Charles Wood was one of 50 students to receive a scholarship. At the Royal College of Music, or RCM, Charles Wood studied with Hubert Parry and Charles Villiers Stanford. He also met his lifelong friend, Sidney Payne Waddington, at RCM. Waddington remarked that Wood's musical skill at age 17 was, quote, amazing, and that he could do any kind of counterpoint with the greatest ease. Fugues, madrigals, complicated exercises in eight parts for double choir gave him no trouble at all, end quote. Waddington also described Charles as a wonderful person who liked joke more than anything in the world. Wood was an outstanding student who had several of his compositions performed professionally while he was still in school. Sir George Grove, the first director at RCM, served as a personal mentor to Charles and highly respected him for his encyclopedic knowledge, so much so that he even cited Wood as a source in his dictionary article, Beethoven and His Nine Symphonies. In 1887, Grove extended Wood's four-year scholarship for another five terms by renaming the award a traveling scholarship. The scholarship extension allowed Wood to study at Selwyn College in Cambridge beginning in 1888 while continuing his composition lessons at RCM. In 1889, Wood received an organ scholarship to study at Gonville and Caius College. During his first year, Grove hired Wood as a lecturer of harmony and counterpoint at the RCM. Wood retained this position for 37 years until his death in 1926. Charles Wood earned his Bachelor of Arts and Bachelor of Music from Gonville and Caius in 1890. The following year, he was hired as the organist for the college. He continued studying there and earned his master's and doctorate in 1894. In the same year, Gonville and Caius awarded him a fellowship. This was considered a huge honor, as Charles Wood was the first professor of music to be named a fellow by any of the University of Cambridge schools. Charles Villiers Stanford notably never received this honor. In 1897, Wood was appointed a lecturer in harmony and counterpoint at Gonville and Caius and devoted the majority of his career to that school. In 1897, he became engaged to Charlotte Georgina Wills Sanford, who was also Irish, studying voice, piano, and counterpoint at the college. They were married on St. Patrick's Day in 1898 and welcomed the birth of their first son in February of 1899, followed later by another son and three daughters. In the following years, Wood was appointed the examiner of the Associate Board and Vice President of the Irish Folk Song Society. In 1904, he received honorary doctorates from Leeds University and Oxford University. In 1924, he was appointed to succeed Charles Stanford as professor of music at the University of Cambridge. The administration wanted Stanford's replacement to be an English resident, an experienced teacher, and someone who would have more teaching responsibilities than Stanford. The administration therefore increased the salary from £250 to £500 when they hired Charles Wood. 2 years later, Wood was diagnosed with cancer. He checked into a nursing home after having surgery and died a month later on July 12, 1926. Charles Wood was regarded as an exceptional teacher who greatly improved the music program at Gonville and Caius College. In 1895, he was associated with the formation of the Scales Club, which was a student-led musical group. He started the college orchestra in 1896. Wood's colleague at Gonville and Caius, Professor E.J. Dent, wrote, quote, "He contributed more than anyone else to the development of musical studies in the university. Stanford, during his long tenure of professorship, did not reside in Cambridge, and although he exercised a valuable directing influence on musical education there, the real burden of teaching fell upon Charles Wood. As a teacher of composition, he was surpassed only by Stanford himself. As a teacher of counterpoint and fugue, he was unequaled," end quote. Charles Wood served as an influential teacher to many successful composers, conductors, and music educators. Some of the most famous students include Rig Vaughan Williams, Herbert Howells, and Sir Michael Tippett, and conductors including Sir Thomas Beecham and Charles Herbert Kitson. Herbert Howells described Wood as his most completely equipped teacher. Wood gave Howells private counterpoint lessons for 5 years. Howells described his weekly lessons as follows, quote, "The quiet voice would be telling me how Bach or Palestrina, Haydn or Mozart would have dealt with this or that technical problem." As a teacher, Charles Wood was an
in numerous genres. He composed chamber operas, two symphonies, chamber music, organ and piano solos, secular part songs, vocal solos, and even a march for band. Sacred choral music was his most prolific genre. He wrote 50 anthems and 52 canticle settings, as well as three short communion services, a mass, and a St. Mark Passion. His choral music is regularly performed as standard repertoire by British cathedral choirs. Wood made an impact with these compositions. According to Dr. James McRae, British Magnificat composition in the early years of the 20th century was dominated by two composers, Charles Villiers Stanford and Charles Wood. He wrote more Magnificat settings than Stanford, and his compositional style helped define contemporary cathedral British choral tradition. The Anglican Church was established in 1534 when Henry VIII broke ties with the Roman Catholic Church. This change in England's religion had a dramatic effect on church services and musical composition. In 1542, the liturgy switched from Latin to English. The Act of Uniformity was implemented in 1549. This legislation made all English churches follow the Book of Common Prayer and established the offices of matins, or morning service, evening song, evening service, and revised the Mass as the communion service. The service was divided into three parts: morning prayer, communion, and evening prayer. The morning prayer typically sets the Venite, Te Deum, and Benedictus canticles. Communion often includes Creed, Kyrie, Gloria, and Sanctus canticles. The evening prayer includes the Magnificat and Nunc Dimittis. In the 16th century, Thomas Tallis and Christopher Tye were considered the pioneers of the Anglican service. Their canticle settings and anthems were written in English and followed the Archbishop of Canterbury's reforms, that vocal music be set syllabically with simple and clear articulation of the English text. In the 1560s and 1570s, a new form of anthem emerged called the verse anthem, which alternated between solo and full chorus sections and had instrumental accompaniment. This was a popular genre since it required less rehearsal time and satisfied the demand for text clarity as mandated by the Act of Uniformity. Bigger churches developed a tradition of singing the liturgy with well-trained choirs, while smaller provincial churches spoke the liturgy and sang hymns as a congregation. Thus, a tradition of large English cathedral choirs was established in numerous parishes, including Durham, Ely, Gloucester, and Westminster Abbey. These choral churches are still active today. The English cathedral choir established the norm of two choirs, Decani and Cantoris. Each choir had 4 to 5 voice parts that faced each other across the central aisle. The south-facing on the dean's side is called the Decani, while the north-facing choir on the precentor's side is called the Cantoris. Many large cathedrals had organs, which began accompanying choirs sometime during the late 16th century. Magnificat and Nunc Dimittis settings became common because the Act of Uniformity required daily performances of matins and evensong canticles. The cathedral choir tradition flourished until 1642, when England's Civil War broke out. Many church choirs were reduced in size due to men serving in the war. After the war in 1660, the primary genre that emerged was the anthem. However, canticles were still composed. During the 18th century, public interest was drawn to instrumental music and opera seria. Anglican church choirs were not as popular, and therefore the general quality of choral performance and literature diminished for over 100 years. However, in the 19th century, the Industrial Revolution led to a wealthier middle class who was interested in music education, musical journalism, and musical societies. A renewed interest in 16th century modalities also concludes with the Gloria Patri. When these canticles are paired, the doxology music from the Magnificat typically returns in the doxology section of the Nunc Dimittis. Wood advanced the canticle genre through his contrast in choral texture, harmony, compositional technique, and text painting. The majority of Wood's settings are in English and generally scored for SATB double choir, the case with his Magnificat and Nunc Dimittis in G major. The Nunc Dimittis in B flat, however, is scored for six voices, which was unusual for Charles Wood. Moreover, this canticle is one of only two Nunc Dimittis settings that does not include Magnificat. In addition, the setting is in Latin, while most of Wood's sacred works are in English. Both of these canticles feature homophonic and syllabic treatment of the text, which corresponds with Anglican canticle tradition. Unlike typical canticles, the Magnificat and Nunc Dimittis in G major are only related by tonality and do not share similar musical treatment of the doxology. Both of these works feature Wood's variety in choral texture, including homophony, antiphony, paired voices, and overlapping phrases. Both the G and B flat major canticles are homophonic, which means all voice parts move rhythmically together. The homophonic texture was favored in Anglican choral settings because it enhanced textual clarity. Antiphony is prevalent in Wood's double choir settings. Please see example one. Most phrases of the Magnificat begin with antiphony, which is a musical dialogue between the two choirs. Antiphony creates a sense of continuity in which sections for one choir end and then another immediately continue in the other choir. In measures 103 to 113, two choirs volley the phrases world without end and amen. Overlapping voice parts also creates a general increase in dynamic. This technique is common in many of Wood's a cappella settings, including the Nunc Dimittis in G. Wood's harmonic progressions also give his canticles a distinctive sound. Example 1 also features a chain of secondary dominants appearing in measures 109 through 113. This circle of fifths progression begins on F sharp major and moves through B major to E major to A major and finally to the dominant of B major that in turn takes the listener back to G major. The choir will now perform example 1. Contrasting sections, similar to an exposition and recapitulation in sonata form, are created through key relationships and reoccurring thematic material. Wood establishes a tonic-dominant relationship between G major and D major in measures 1 through 43. In measure 31, the melody of Mi Re Re Ti Do is the secondary key of D major, appearing in the Dakani tenor line and is harmonized in the Dakani bass line. Tenor and bass parts in the cantoris sustain the dominant on A in long tones. This Mi Re Re Ti Do duet melody reappears at measure 70 in the key of G major sung by the Dakani alto and tenor. Cantoris tenor and bass parts sing the dominant on D this time. The restatement of this melody thus evokes a recapitulatory principle, one that also provides an example of text painting, where the tenor and alto parts think back on God's help to his servant Israel. They once again sing the words, "He remembering his mercy," with all voice parts in the cantoris sustaining a unison D pedal in octaves. Variation in compositional technique is exemplified in the Nunc Dimittis, which features a blend of medieval and classical sounds. Please see example 2. Unlike the Magnificat setting, the text is introduced three times by an alto, tenor, bass trio, with the full choral texture entering on the final words of trio texture is interesting because it is partly written in a faubourdon style. Faubourdon is a 15th century compositional technique that commonly features three voices singing in parallel motion, most often in verse conversion. The trio texture is written in a middle range and only spans an octave to an octave and a fifth. This limited tessitura dramatically contrasts with the eight-part choral textures, which extend 2.5 octaves. Another archaic feature is the melodic contour in the alto part in the Toscani, which sounds similar to a Landini cadence. This type of cadence was named after Francesco Landini, a 14th century Italian composer. The Landini cadence is, quote, a cadential formula in which the sixth scale degree is interposed between the leading note and its resolution on the tonic or final scale degree, end quote. In measures 125, 132, 136, 137, 138, and you guessed it, 142, alto line has this cadential formula as an important melodic motif of ti-la-do. The archaic sounds are contrasted by the harmonic shift from G major to B major in measures 134 to 135. This third relationship is reflective of modern harmony. The eight-part textures echoing all people is another example of text painting. The choir will now perform example two. Music further exemplifies classical and romantic compositional techniques by tonicizing the relative minor key of E minor or modulating to a key center a major third away. Please look at example three. In measures 149 through 150 of the Nunc Dimittis in G, E flat major is briefly tonicized. Wood then alters the E flat chord by adding a C sharp to create an inverted augmented sixth chord that resolves to a second inversion G major chord. This section is set antiphonally on the words "and to be the glory," with the sixth chord written in the Toscani and the cantoris echoing the G major resolution at measure 151. In this climactic moment at 151, the soprano part in both choirs ascend above the staff in contrary motion, with the Toscani bass line descending to a low G. Wood often employs contrary motion in his works to display the apex of the phrase. The choir will now perform example three.
To be the glory.
bass and treble voices echoing each other. One further varies the choral texture by occasionally writing short trio passages and even a short polyphonic entrance. Example 5 demonstrates short polyphonic entrances on text painting and text painting on the word lumen. Lumen is part of the phrase lumen ad revelationem gentium, which translates to be a light, to lighten the Gentiles. Each entrance creates more light shed on the people. In measures 19 through 21, the music modulates from B flat major to D flat major through a common tone of F on the word lumen. The F major chord serves as the dominant to B flat major and a mediant or third in D flat major. A succession of lush seventh chords modulate the key center back to an F major chord. The choir will now perform example 5. Develops the canticle genre through variation in choral texture, harmony, and employment of text painting. Antiphony, homophony, paired voicing, and short imitative phrases are features of his choral texture. His compositional technique included archaic styles and classical sonata form traits. Wood's harmonic language included extended harmonies, common tone modulations, and third relationships. The harmonic shifts often depicted text painting. These musical features set Wood's canticles apart. The choir will now perform Nunc Dimittis in B flat.
Thank you.
which refers to a type of plain song that was sung before and after psalms and canticles. An injunction by Queen Elizabeth in 1559 gave composers liberty to freely compose modest hymns or such like song for Anglican services, which gave birth to the English anthem. Anthems avoided praising the Virgin Mary or any of the saints. Similar to the canticle setting, the anthem was set in English in a homophonic texture and written syllabically so the text could be easily understood. Most anthems were a cappella, but some anthems were written with organ accompaniment. Wood wrote 50 anthems, which greatly contributed to the revitalization of the English anthem. Wood's anthems are distinctive through a blend of compositional techniques, including 19th century harmony and text painting that heightens emotional expression. His anthems are usually scored for SATB or SATB double choir, either a cappella or with organ accompaniment. Glory and Honor and Laud is written for a cappella choir. Expectans Expectavi and O Thou the Central Orb are written for SATB choir and organ. Several of Wood's anthems feature ancient hymn texts and melodies. Glory and Honor and Laud adapts text from a 9th century Latin hymn, Gloria Laus et Honor, written by Theodulf Orleans in 1820 AD. Anglican clergyman John Mason Neal translated the Latin into English in 1894 to create the familiar hymn, All Glory, Laud, and Honor. The overall form of this anthem is a quasi-rondo form with a coda. Ostinato, Chimiola, and Canon are rarely associated with Anglican church hymns, but Wood infuses these compositional techniques into Glory and Honor and Laud. Wood writes a four-note ostinato pattern in the tenor line at measure 56. An ostinato is a short repeated pattern. The descending quarter note scalar pattern in the ostinato adds variety to the tonal harmony, since added seventh or ninth scale degrees are often found in the tenor part. The ostinato is also interesting rhythmically because the four-note ostinato is set in triple meter, so the pattern is always offset. In several restatements of the A refrain, chimiolas, or two against three, create additional rhythmic contrast. Glory and Honor also features canon in measure 164 through 176. Please see example 6. Canon is the strict restatement of melody by one or more voices. In this instance, the Glory and Honor melody is restated 7 times within 13 measures. The original modal melody is also altered in the same. King Christ the Redeemer employs C sharp and G sharp, suggesting A major instead of D Dorian. The choir will now perform example 6. Expectans Expectavi is an English anthem with a Latin title. The Latin title is from Psalm 40, I Waited Patiently for the Lord. But the text comes from a poem written by Scottish poet Charles Hamilton Sorley. He received a scholarship to University College in Oxford, but left school to enlist and fight in World War I. He did not survive, and his death at age 20 was considered one of the greatest artistic losses of World War I. Wood was drawn to Sorley's poetry because he also lost his eldest son, who was only 18 years old, in World War I. The opening organ introduction exhibits several interesting harmonic features. Please see example 7. In measures 3, 7, 11, and 12, we find expressive suspensions, predominantly 6-5, but also 9-8 and 4-3 suspensions. Extended harmonies in the form of added ninth chords appear in measures 7, 9, and 10. The organ introduction also features augmented and half-diminished seventh chords prior to cadences on the tonic key of D flat major. The organist will now perform example 7. also instances of text painting in this anthem. In measures 30 through 31, the word tarry, which means to linger, stretches over the length of two full measures. In measures 51 to 56, the words "thy servant stands" is sung in unison with a descending melodic line, as if a soldier has fallen. The organ part also features a descending sequential four-note pattern, as if the soldier is stumbling. In measure 64, the choir sings a fully diminished seventh chord on the word "early." An entire measure of rest follows, perhaps serving as a moment of silence to honor those fallen. Wood's anthem, "O Thou the Central Orb," features text written by Anglican Reverend Henry Ramson Ramley, who wrote many hymn texts and carols. This anthem is largely homophonic and syllabic, drawing upon traditional Anglican choral sounds. Classical modulations and lush extended harmonies are prevalent throughout this piece. The overall form is ABA prime. Please see example 8. In measures 21 through 29, the middle B section modulates to the relative minor mode, which is F minor. This F minor section begins a flat side circle of fifths progression that tonicizes D flat to G flat and then C flat. This section features a unison bass solo, which contrasts the homophonic choral texture. The solo line and organ part employ chromaticism that draws from the melodic minor scale. The choir will now perform example 8. Ancient and modern techniques in glory and honor demonstrates Wood's desire to look back and forward as a composer. Ostinato and hemiola found in glory and honor are seldom found in English anthems. The poignant text painting perhaps reflects his own grief in Expectans Expectavi. O Thou the Central Orb draws upon traditional Anglican choral works with homophonic text setting and organ accompaniment. Varying compositional techniques, contrasting harmony, and text painting elevates Wood's anthems. Charles Wood's sacred choral music exemplifies his appreciation for music history and theory. This is evident in his classical formal structures, Baroque antiphonal writing, medieval cadences with contrasting romantic progressions, and his effective use of Renaissance text painting and use of forbidden. He composed music inspired by his faith and personal experiences, and yet his largely homophonic sacred choral music makes it accessible for amateur and advanced choirs. Wood had a significant impact on major British composers and conductors in the 20th century. He lived to serve others as a music educator. His work in the classroom influenced future generations, but without the fame received by his contemporaries. His music was a reflection of his profession, showing a deep understanding of the past and composing music that served as a model for his students. Wood has been equated with Charles Stanford, but his composition student, Margaret Nosek, asserted that Wood's music was, quote, higher in quality, it is certainly deeper emotionally, end quote. She spoke fondly of him in 1996 in a personal memoir in the Musical Times Journal. Quote, Wood was one of those steadfast, true musicians of whom England has produced so many to her glory, who shed their inner light around them, end quote. His obituary suggests that if he had been in better health and more outgoing, Wood may have had the fame of his Royal College of Music colleagues. It reads, quote, he may be said to have sacrificed his own work as a composer for the benefit of those to whom he taught composition, end quote. Charles Wood deserves to be recognized for his contribution to British cathedral choral music and the vast number of musicians he impacted as a music educator. I would like to acknowledge the many people who supported me in preparing this lecture recital. First, I would like to to give a big shout out to my baristas, Skaya and Sophia from the Milton Starbucks, who served me with endless basic white girl beverages and positivity. They are here today. Thank you. Thank you to Tom Peterson for generously fixing formatting issues with the anthem Glory and Honor and Laud. He put in hours of work and refused to let me pay him. Thank you, Reverend Cindy Parker, John and Suzanne Moore, and the entire Church of the Red Rocks congregation for allowing me to use this beautiful church and organ for the lecture recital. Thank you to Greg Chenoweth for spending hours formatting my program and musical examples. Thank you for always being patient with me, even when I, quote, type like a 100-year-old woman. His words. Thank you, Mrs. Jennifer Saunders, for your kindness and patience while reprinting all of my lecture programs. I greatly appreciate you. Thank you to Dr. Todd Sullivan for allowing me to hold my lecture recital here at Church of the Red Rocks. Thank you for also proofreading my program. Dr. Ryan Holder, thank you for allowing me to use the Sedona Academy of Chamber Singers as a demonstration choir. Thank you for always looking out for me and for having my back. You are such a kind and caring person and excellent music educator. Thank you for being a mentor to me. I would like to recognize the 24 volunteers from the Sedona Academy of Chamber Singers who graciously dedicated their time and energy to sing in this demonstration choir. None of these students were required to sing in this recital. They didn't receive any academic credit or payment. Thank you for dedicating your precious time and energy. It truly means the world to me. Thank you to my incredible lecture recital committee of Dr. Stephen Brown, Dr. Julie Hedges Brown, and Dr. Edith Copley. Please know that you inspired me to work my absolute best. Dr. Stephen Brown, you have once again demonstrated the impact of a great teacher with a kind and patient attitude. My analytical skills have greatly improved because of you. Thank you for dedicating your time to helping me analyze this music. Dr. Julie Hedges Brown, you have amazed me from the very first day of Baroque history class last spring. Your passion for music history is so inspiring to me and many other students. I have been so exceptionally blessed to call you my teacher and to receive your excellent guidance in this process. Dr. Copley, I am so lucky to study with you. You are a role model to me and so many people in and outside of NEU. You have helped me grow as a musician, educator, and human being. I have learned so much about choral music from you, but so much more about life. You have been with me every step of the way in this lecture recital process, and were incredibly kind and patient. Thank you for being my role model and taking a chance on me. I want to say a special thank you to my graduate colleagues, Sarah Urban, Albert Lee, Ryan Phillips, Ben Saunders, and Stephen Schaefer. Not every graduate cohort supports one another like we do. You have become my second family here at NAU. Thank you for all the ways you helped me. Reading my paper, leading sectionals, helping me with music theory, practicing the organ, encouraging me, you can do it, lifting me up, and just being really good friends. I would like to acknowledge my family who supported me by traveling from the East Coast, West Coast, and Midwest to attend this recital today. Thank you for believing in me even when I did not. Thank you for always being there to support me. Thank you for giving me the courage to pursue my dreams. I love you and thank you. Finally, thank you to my wonderful boyfriend, Tanner, who sat by my side almost every single weekend and weeknight while I analyzed chords, read dissertations, and typed away on my laptop. You've been my rock. I told you in August that I was going to need a cheerleader this semester, and I couldn't have asked for anyone more supportive than you. Thank you, and I love you. All right, man, the Sedona Academy of Chamber Singers will now perform Glory, Honor, and Laud, Expectans Expectavi, and O Thou, the Central Orb. Thank you all so much for coming today. It's been great.
Glory and honor and love be to thee, King Christ the Redeemer.